Welcome, everybody. Goons, 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 and George, because I know you're listening. This is the Set the Narrative podcast, second episode we've got. I'm joined with Captain Corpulence.
Here, here.
And Marty had some trolling business he had to take care of, so he won't be with us today, but he is with us in spirit, just like Mark Reblet is letting us use his channel again. Thank you, Mark. Today we're going to be covering several different topics. One of them is going to be the Jamie voicemail that Mark released on his channel a couple days ago. Another one's going to be a DM that Jamie sent Angela that Angela released to us. And then we're going to have some more comments from Angela that she left in the Discord. And we're going to talk about Roger's video too, because I think that deserves to be talked about. Roger's video, Mr. Pig. And then we got,
that's funny because Roger snorts like a pig and Gigi is just a pig.
Yeah. I don't know if Roger's snorting around George. That might be too much stinky air to be taking.
Oh, in God.
At one time. Probably close to killing himself.
But, well, I was going to say it's good. His nose is congested. You know, yeah.
All right. First order of business is Jamie's voicemail. Now a lot of you have probably already listened to that. We're going to go ahead and play it again just for anybody that's listening to this that hasn't heard it or needs a refresher on what it said. Very disturbing. Viewer discretion or listener discretion advised on this. Let's go ahead and give it a quick listen here.
Come on, man. Who the fuck are you? Why you gotta play this shit? I don't have time for this shit. I gave you the pants. I said put them in the dryer. Can I have my pants back now? Now you're trying to tell me they walked out of the dryer by themselves. You thought you put them in the dryer. We were there when I put them in the dryer. You were right there. I said, why don't you get this shit fixed? It was all busted up and dirty and nasty, and I cleaned up the laundry room. And I said, wash my shit. And now you're trying to tell me they just walked off. They just walked off. So now what? I'm supposed to wait in your house with no pants on for you to come back for me? Fuck you. You better give me something to wear. I'm not hanging around here because you lost my pants. Fucking loser. God, Jesus, I'm a goddamn hostage in this bitch every fucking time. Every time I agree to talk to you. Pull this weird-ass fucking shit on me, man. God, I don't even want to see you ever again in my life. Take it away. Cannot be away. Oh, I've got your pants, I've got your shoes. It's all a fucking lie. It's so creepy. I'm ready to let all my shit go, man. Just leave me alone. Just leave me the fuck alone. God, fuck. I don't want to kill myself every time I see your fucking goddamn creepy, dirty, fucking stinky ass. I want to just kill myself.
Right. In listening to that, there's a lot to unpack in this voicemail. Now, I want to preface with one thing. So, Roger did bring up in his video that who knows if this is Jamie. Well, you can hear George at about the 32nd or 38 second mark in the background yelling at her. If you make the video really loud, you can hear him in the background. We've never heard Jamie's voice, but given the channel that this came from, that it was run by Angela, the channel Toothless Sue, there's also another voicemail left from George to Angela on there about Jamie getting the restraining order filed against him. So I'll leave a description to that channel or a link to that channel in the description. But I mean, Captain, give me your first impressions of when you first listened to this. What were you thinking?
My jaw was on the floor when I first heard this. Number one, I thought, who could this be that left this voicemail? And number two, again, it confirms so many things that we've suspected for so long. It just seems like as time goes on, more and more is confirmed that we always suspected about George, and it turns out to be true. One of the first things that Jamie says, if it is Jamie, I'll preface that, we don't know 100%, but the signs seem to say that it is, can I have my pants back now? George, by his own admission, said that they fought like a married couple. That seems like a really normal thing for a married couple to argue about, stealing one another's pants.
Yeah, and Jamie says, too, that he cut her shoes, too, so that she couldn't leave. And she felt like a hostage inside of that house. And let's not you know, glades over at the very end. The big gem is that every Jamie admits that every single time she hangs around George, she wants to kill herself. And we can only assume that after that, when George stopped talking to her, he was still stalking her. He admits that in several Saunders calls, and she probably saw him. And then, you know, we'll have a message that we're going to look at soon that just outlines that George is so fearful of this wrongful death suit because he knows that there's substance behind it. And this voicemail proves that.
It makes me wonder, what other lengths did he go to keep her there? You know, he was a pit in his basement away from being Buffalo Bill from Silence of the Lambs. And I mean, did he have caltrops in his lawn and like cut her shoes so that she had to go around barefoot and step on caltrops and come back inside? It's pretty devious shit.
It's something, you know, it could be questioned if this is real or not, because one, I didn't think that George even owned a washer and dryer given the state of his clothes, let alone that he's washing Jamie's clothes. Maybe she had higher hygiene standards than him. It wouldn't be hard to have that, but
I'm surprised that he even knows how to operate a washer and dryer, to be completely honest. The guy, when you see the state of his house, he doesn't know how to do any kind of cleaning in the first place. How would he possibly understand how to use a washer and dryer? It would also explain the state of his clothes.
Mm-hmm. Yep, he's got that piss-stained white jacket. He's got the blue shirt with the white collar. It's all dingy and yellow that Saunders pointed out to him. And, of course, he gets offended. This must have been a time where George had running water in his house, so it must have been early on. I'm not sure. But we've heard stories from multiple women, including Angela and Karen, when she came on the Facebook page back in 2018, that George has a history of abusive behavior. And this is just solid, solid proof that George is a serial abuser, and he takes advantage of people in their vulnerable states. And when they don't conform to what he wants, he will try to hold them hostage, according to Jamie, and will do anything in his power to keep them around.
Well, and a normal person wouldn't feel the rage that he exhibits. Early on, before he was trolled for years at a time, early on, when you see the prank callers, you could see the fire start to rage inside him the minute somebody insults him. So it makes sense that this is a guy that is easily pushed over the edge. And could do something like what is alleged about the 14-year-old kid that he supposedly beat the shit out of and went to court over. It all kind of fits.
Yes, it does. And we're going to see later on, too, like I said, just this continuing behavior. And if you thought the voicemail was bad, wait till we get to this message. And but the voicemail, when I first heard it, the same thing with you, man. My jaw was on the floor. I couldn't believe what I was hearing. It was so damning. And we still haven't heard George come out and try and spin the narrative. And I would love for George to come on and make another tirade video trying to explain this voicemail off. I don't even know how you could do it. How do you think George could, in George's warped, twisted mind, how could he even attempt to spin this narrative? The only defense that he would have is that it wasn't Jamie. And I don't buy that it's not Jamie.
Yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. You notice how convenient it is for him to just ignore certain things. When he tried to offer a rebuttal to our video where we spoke about some of the things that we learned, he didn't really deny almost anything. Almost all of it he tried to justify. Even like those pictures of his house, he made it sound as if that was kind of normal and that bachelors always have dog shit and food on the floor and stuff like that, as if that's a natural thing for a man his age to do.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and so George, even talking about it, going to his tirade for a second, he conveniently glazed over the parts where he was accused of beating his aunt and getting sent to jail and having all of his stuff stolen by his roommates. He also glazed over him whipping that black boy with the towel and beating the shit out of him. Those convenient things that he just, you know, didn't want his fans to hear. What fans are watching him on Facebook? He, on his streams, he even says, oh, looks like we got one person watching. And he says the same thing on his birthday bash video. Oh, looks like we got two people watching now. And I guarantee one of them is George, tuned into or has that web or that open on another web browser. So there's one viewer. And then who knows, someone else might be Hank Cook in a fit of dementia pulls up the wrong live stream or something.
Let's not forget, too, one of the things that Jamie mentioned in there. Dirty, stinky ass.
Mm-hmm.
Dirty, stinky ass. When have you ever called someone that you care about dirty and stinky and creepy? All things that she mentions in that message, that hardly sounds like a loving relationship to me. What it sounded like was a woman that was at her wit's end, desperate to escape and unable to escape, and a man that is sabotaging things around her to keep her in place.
Mm-hmm. He is, instead of providing a loving, caring, place, situation for her to get back on her feet, because that's what George always parrots is, if she was still here, or if I was still in her life, she'd still be here, blah blah blah. Yeah, if he was still in her life, he'd still be stealing her pants and cutting her shoes up and be holding her hostage in that hell house that was 1307. And I think now we're gonna see that George, he's sabotaging this situation for someone who really, really needs a stable environment to live in, to get off the drugs, and for someone to be a solid rock in their life that they can lean on. And if they really were the quote married couple or whatever he said, this conversation wouldn't have happened. I don't know, outside of stories you hear from abused women. In terrible relationships, you don't hear conversations or tales like this that you're hearing in this voicemail.
Yeah, I mean, what she was is she was a victim, a drowning victim. She was barely treading water, and George, being the gallant gentleman that he is, he tossed her a cinder block instead of a life preserver.
Yeah, that's a good way to put it. I agree with that 100%. But according to George, correct narrative, that's not how it was. We don't know anything. We weren't there. And George, George wasn't accused of, or George didn't rape Jamie just like OJ didn't kill Nicole. Like George's defense for it, his, rape allegations against Jamie was he was never charged with anything. He didn't do that because, it's not on the books. You don't, a lot of rapes in that happen, and sexual assaults and stuff like that often go unreported. And I believe fully that if we had Jamie's information back then, we could have provided her a solid, network to, provide emotional support for her and to help her try and move forward with this, these rape charges against George. Because wouldn't you love to see George on the stand being accused of all this? Because that's another thing that George parrots. I'm not on stand. I don't got to answer these questions. I would love to see George on stand. That's one thing that I was kind of sad that we didn't see in the court case, was George being put on stand.
Well, if you listen to him, he didn't say half the things that that is alleged that he had said.
Oh, yeah, I forgot about that. Yeah, that's right.
But I want to go back to the OJ comment that you made a moment earlier. Wasn't his book called If I Did It? And then if you think about George's book called What Is Causing All This, it kind of, putting Jamie in mind, kind of puts a new spin on that title.
Yes, what is causing all of this? What is causing Jamie to feel like she has no recourse in life but to take a hot shot speedball and kill herself? George is what's causing all of that. Yes.
God, I mean, anything to probably get her out of that dreary existence when she was at 1307.
If only the new people that live in this, that live in 1307, knew what happened, they'd probably move out. There's got to be some bad juju going on inside that house. I'm convinced of it.
Oh, absolutely. They would need to hire an exorcist or something.
Yeah, if someone's knocking holy water around there, or just burn the place to the ground. That works too. Moving on, the next item of business we have in setting the narrative straight is this message that was posted by Angela in our Discord, that Jamie sent her 10 days before she died. And you can see in this little message here, it's time stamped at 11:18, April 10th, and Jamie died on April 20th. And this, Angela confirmed that this was sent shortly before that, that year that she died. And this is going to look a little bit different from current Facebook messages. If you're questioning the authenticity of it, if did it come from Facebook, this is how these messages looked 4 or 5 years ago. So I'm going to go ahead and read it here. Jamie responded, absolutely. I tried again to be nice just so he doesn't go completely berserk when he realizes that it's actually over with him and me, since just about every single one of my friends is convinced that he's going to murder me sooner or later. But he turned it into this game where you've got to fully commit to him as your God and Savior, or you are a filthy cunt. That's what he called me today because I told him to have a good night when I was apparently supposed to have decided to skip work and cuddle with him in his bed, in parentheses, full of lizards. I told him, and I guess to hell with my stuff if he decides to be evil. I said that in the moment that I realized how very ridiculous it was for me to even entertain his childish and unbelievable self-centered bullshit. So until he could talk to me for more than 3 minutes without mentioning his cock or insulting me in some dumb, foul-mouthed way, then I am done. He was livid. Went right back to calling me a stupid whore and all of his favorites. I told him that he wasn't helping his case and that he said I was playing games with his head, which is his favorite thing to say when he doesn't understand something or it just has nothing else to say. Whatever. I don't care anymore. Now that I'm not getting drunk, I can't deal with him, and I just see what a silly waste of energy it is to concern myself. What he still fails to realize is that I've been lost to him for, what, a month now? The moment that I stopped staying there, still drunk enough that I should have been able to deal with it, but I couldn't even deal with that shit drunk anymore. The moment I decided, yes, it's far better to be sleeping in a filthy boiler room in a basement of a building I was technically breaking into, I was already gone. Good night to you. Smiley emoji.
Good God.
What a hard-hitting message. I would love to see a narrative spin of this, too, from good old Georgie Porgy. We got Angela commenting about the wild, and her talking about being drunk, which we've already know George was a fan of doing, of allowing her to get drunk so she would stay and would be more sexually friendly to him, and she's backing that up right here. Captain, what do you think?
You know, the thing that really leaped out at me the first thing is how Jamie alludes to having to bow down and submit to him. And it's just like any interaction we've seen with him with someone else where everything has to be on his terms. He is like a beggar on the street. I mean, he's not far away from that, who tells anybody that is trying to give him money, oh, wait, no, nothing below 50 cents, you know, setting the terms on things that he should be grateful for to have in the first place. He's a pauper. He is literally a pauper, and he's making demands like he's some kind of king. Just that's so typical of him.
Yes, and we also see here more telltale signs of Georgisms that when George gets mad at a woman for any reason or he feels like she wrongs him, the immediate thing that he does is cuss and insult her, calling her a filthy cunt, saying, you know, that she's playing games. And he alludes to that sometimes in the Saunders calls that, you know, she thought that she was playing games with him. She was manipulative. And he's accused other people he's dated of doing the same thing. And this just speaks to him to a T that he gets mad and immediately starts going after her. And it's pathetic behavior. It's weak room temperature IQ behavior from George here. And I expect nothing less from him.
Well, and also, I think it confirms something else that I've long suspected, and I think we've talked about before, is he's very quick to interpret almost anything as an insult or a slight against him. And that kind of speaks to how he must have grown up, how school must have been for him, how he was shaped, how he became what he is now, which is a person that has just a hair trigger temper and a hair trigger lack of belief in himself, where anything that is said, he immediately assumes that it's negative and it's an insult. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, there's a reason for that, because most of the time it is.
Yes. And there's also, you know, people will say something to George, like Saunders will say, oh, you know, your shirt's dirty, you should probably wash it, or people have brought up his fingernails all the time. And instead of actually looking at his fingernails, or looking at how dirty his clothes are that need to be stain treated or just thrown out because they can't be fixed or they can't be cleansed enough. He just takes it as an insult. They're wrong. He's right. Nothing that someone says to him is objective. It's always a slight, like you said. It's always an insult. It's always, there's no such thing to George as constructive criticism.
Yeah, and I think one of his defenses when Saunders would say things like that to him was that somebody else would have told me if that was true. Somebody else would have said something to me. But how would they do that when you don't want to take any criticism? You don't want to accept anyone else's version of events. No one is going to tell you. And who do you really have in your life in the first place that is going to tell you? The people you interact with on a daily basis are probably just DoorDash customers and no one else because your life is empty.
And we've seen from various people on Reddit that had him as a DoorDasher that he does indeed have stinky clothes and he smells and is unkept, which, I mean, can you look at that? Look at some of the tirade videos he's made since he's moved out of the bank's house and just how disheveled and nasty he looks. It just, if he's not in Candlewood once a night, he's not showering unless he's taking a horse bath somewhere and, you know, a gas station bathroom. But going back to the message, Jamie's talking about, you know, that even when she was still drunk as hell, she would rather sleep in a boiler room in the basement of a building that she's breaking into than staying with George.
That's sad.
It's very sad that this is the state that George reduced their relationship down to, the state of the living situation that she was in. This message was sent several, almost, I think it was about 2 months after, 2-3 months after George and her stopped talking, and she still holds this amount of animosity towards him over that. And George is still, you know, they're not talking. Jamie feels like this, and George is still over there playing that puppy dog, you know, love sick type of bullshit that, like Angela said, he just paints that narrative so that he can elicit sympathy from people that they had this loving relationship when Jamie didn't want anything to do with him at the end. And it sounds like from our voicemail that she just wavered off and on. Like, she would get tired of his shit, then she would get desperate enough to go back, but then she would realize that she made a mistake, and eventually she was done. But not George. They weren't done, according to George. They weren't done until he said they were done. So he's going to follow her. He's going to be calling her on New Year's Eve and on Christmas Eve to check in to see, quote, how she's doing. He likes where she's staying so that he can check up on her, as he told Saunders in one of the calls. And just disgusting predatorial behavior. Predatory stalking, if you will.
That he is so familiar with. Now we know why.
Mm-hmm.
And you have to wonder, too, she's saying that this boiler room was filthy. Could it really have been any dirtier than Casa Yeri?
If it didn't have any lizards, it was an automatic step up.
Yeah, you can just know that he makes himself at home anytime he sees a lizard.
We're now going to look at some comments that Angela left on the Discord for us shortly after she was commenting on the YouTube video. So, Captain, if you want to go ahead and read the first comment.
So the very first thing that was asked to Angela was, did George ever talk about his high school days? And she said, no, he did have a crush on some girl, though. She thought he was a stalker. What was it that George said a long time ago? He was like, you got that one and you nailed that one, something like that. But man, she had his ass fucking pegged. He couldn't, I mean, he's the epitome of a stalker. Look at Jenny from the insurance doctor having to basically insult him to make him go away. The girls at Starbucks that hid in the back. And then Jamie, all the things she went to, cutting shoes, yes, caltropping his lawn, all sorts of different shit.
Or Karen, that he was outside her house calling her number and trying to get her to pick up. It's creepy stuff.
You know who else did that? Ted Bundy. He used to lurk high outside people's houses.
maybe that's what George did. He hid the bodies in the basement and the lizards eventually ate them.
He's like he had a built-in disposal system. okay, so the next thing, I asked, did you know that Jamie was a prostitute? And then it looks like you asked, did George know that Jamie was a prostitute? So both of us asked the same thing. Angela said, he gave her a puppy in a box. He forgot to feed and water it. what he gave it to, or it was almost dead and the box was full of dog crap.
George loves animals, though.
Well, that's like, I mean, maybe that was normal for him. It sounds like the dogs pissed and shit all over his house, and maybe he just thought that was normal. You know,
He
dogs
was
just.
just, he was trying to make the dog feel at home. It was either piss and shit in the box or piss and shit on the carpet and or the oriental rug that's still worth something that he had in his family room. One
Oh,
of the
that was the
two.
one that he wanted to give to Saunders as collateral,
Yeah. It's still worth something. I got a Baber rug from my great grandpa who hypnotized my grandma
right?
back in like, 1958 or some shit like that.
I don't want some pissed on dog rug.
So.
And then it looks like Angela's next comment was, no, he looked her up her record and found the charge. Okay,
Yeah.
so.
Yeah. So George in a Saunders call says that he just acts like he's blindsided by Jamie's prostitution charges and doesn't believe it. And then says, and I quote, "Either they say that I raped Jamie, but they also say that she was a prostitute. So either she was a prostitute or I raped her. Which one was it?" So in George's mind, if you're a prostitute, you can't rape a prostitute. They're just automatic sex objects that you can have sex with whenever you want, and they don't have any rights, is essentially what George is saying. Just despicable, misogynistic bullshit.
Well, you know, he is a penniless pauper,
Yes.
so he wouldn't really have the option of
Yeah.
paying for it.
Yeah,
So that explains a lot right there.
he busted his daddy money load all over those nasty call girls that he had Polaroids of. That was so funny. He had a Polaroid of a naked hooker inside of a hotel room, and this hotel room looked like something like a hotel, like Days Inn or some Nights Inn, some shitty thing like that. Not some classy Vegas hotel. And that also, the chick was ugly. So George acts all high and mighty that he only gets call girls in Vegas when he's getting the bottom of the barrel call girls like Sue or this ugly stripper that they found in the bank's house.
Well, it looked like too on that picture that you're talking about, if I remember correctly, he wrote a message to himself, but made it look like it was the girl that wrote it. But it
Yeah.
was obviously the same handwriting from his handwritten court documents.
Yeah, it was like that picture he made of Sue when Sue's head cut out from a picture on his body and then Kevin as the baby. That just creepy delusional stuff that and it's like also when George would read his fan mail on a show and it would really just be bills that he was reading the back of. That no one cares about his situation with that stupid drugged out whore Sue or anything like that. No one cares about his dysfunctional relationships or wants to ask about him at least.
Well, and there he is, a grown man playing with paper, essentially paper dolls.
Yeah, imagine making that. Imagine sitting down and getting these pictures together and a stock photo of a family and being like, "You know what would be a really good idea? If I cut these pictures out and taped them on or glued them on here and made this funny picture, that would be awesome. I bet people would think that's really funny, and that's something that I'm gonna hang up in my house." Imagine that.
Well, I don't need to imagine it because he really did it, which is disturbing.
The state of the yard mind is just decrepit, deteriorated, and degenerate.
Like his house.
Like his house. Yes. Okay.
So the next comment, I asked, do you think George has a learning disability or did he ever comment about being diagnosed with anything? And Angela replied, no, his mother had schizophrenia and didn't take care of him when he was a baby. She would just leave him in the crib all day. Didn't pick him up and feed him or change his diapers. When his father came home, he would beat her up. He would beat up the mother for not doing anything all day. I think he has some form of learning disability and personality disorder because of this.
It's no question that George has a learning disability. That's pretty
I
obvious.
mean, yeah, you just look at his court documents. You listen to him speak. I mean, this is a guy who claims that he learned how to be a public speaker by going to school, but he uses words like stole.
Yeah, documentate is another good one. I mean, there's so many butchered words in the English language that George cannot pronounce to save his life.
Even low.
Even low. He says, yeah, I love the comments that point that out on the video. Why does George say low instead of though? That's a great question. You can only ask the pig himself why he's so dumb that doesn't know the difference between the two words.
Well, since he won't ever really truly address anything that we say, I'm sure we'll never get an answer to that one either.
Yeah, when he goes and makes a tirade and plays his video for his fans, he's going to skip over that little segment that we just said.
Yeah, he conveniently skipped over most of the truly damning stuff in the other videos.
Which was no surprise. Yeah, that doesn't shock me either. It looks like Sean Boner Park Fagala says, "Hi Angela, George always fancies himself as a ladies' man, which leads to the question: is that all that he claims is down there? Is he as good of a lover as he says he is?" And Angela says, "I wouldn't know. I had an agreement with him to have a child, but when I met him, he was really weird and dirty looking. I changed my mind. I told him that it was my time of the month for me. He kept asking me for money and stole my car rental key so I couldn't leave the hotel because I wouldn't go with him to his workplace. I was planning on driving to Williamsburg, so the trip was not a total waste of time and money. He said he took them by mistake. George likes to trap women against their will."
Jamie, good Lord.
The Jamie voicemail. Yeah.
That's exactly the same thing. I mean, when he meets a woman that he's interested in, I bet his mind just immediately starts going through the motions on figuring out what he can do to keep her from leaving. You know, trying to disable her or slashing her tires, anything to keep her from fleeing.
Mm-hmm. And then I asked Angela, did Gigi ever elaborate on why he chose Ric Flair persona to emulate? And she said, "I'm not sure. I don't even know who Ric Flair was until I met him." I mean, George is unoriginal as hell. Every single thing he says is stolen from something else. He can't even create his own skits. His claim to fame, legendary skit that he's done, that grandma clipped the toenails, whatever that horrendous thing is stolen from a random obscure SNL skit. I have never met a person. I've actually asked a couple people that are older that would have remembered that skit in the, you know, the 80s. Do you remember the Hurley Boy? I'm like, I don't know what that is. Can you even find that on YouTube if you Google it? So like, George rips off his entire persona. Every single thing he says about himself is ripped off and stolen. And then even his name is stolen from another famous wrestler. Nothing about the man is original, except for his stench. that's an original yard exclusive stink that he's got going on.
Yes, the recipe is protected inside a big bank vault, but the bank probably actually owns it.
The bank smell.
So one thing I find really funny is it's perfectly normal for adults to love and be into wrestling. Mm-hmm. That's a perfectly normal thing. So I'm not making any suggestion that there's anything weird about that.
No, not at all.
But to be a 50-something-year-old man emulating a wrestler in your day-to-day life, that's disturbing. That's weird. Only a weirdo. What did they call him? A flamboyant weirdo? Yeah. Only a flamboyant weirdo would do something like that. Like 2012, right? You'd comment defending Gigi till obviously things went south. Weren't you like Queen of Hearts 1 or something? And Angela said, "I'm not sure who that is. George did not like me commenting on YouTube. That is why he is trying to discredit me. I stopped talking to him because he wanted me to stalk some woman in jail for him named Ellen Ferguson. He expects all of his friends to stalk women he is interested in." Oh my God.
Yeah, Ellen worked at the insurance doctor, and she was the one that said that he was very stinky and that his show sucked, and why he switched insurance doctors to get it, because he was too ashamed of being rejected and knew that they didn't want him around anymore.
I would like to get we should start a list of all the women that have said George is stinky. Jamie is on that list, as is this person. I mean, probably it's just a matter of reaching out to women that have actually been around him. I can't remember if Angela said he stinks too.
I'm sure she thought it. That's why she only went down there a couple times. She probably realized that after the second one that this is not worth it. My olfactory is going to just give out if I'm around this guy any longer. So I'm just going to cut my losses, and we're never coming back. Looks like Marty asked Angela, "What do you know about George's bankruptcy?" And she said, I don't. I know that he got the money to pay it from one of his friends that is a cab driver. I think the guy's name is Rocky, and I bet he didn't pay him back. Well, we know he didn't because he didn't pay back the Russians that were supposed to deliver his coupon books. So.
That was the first thing I thought of was the Russians. George running away from the Russians and being hounded by the Russians.
And you asked, this is very damning. This was bef now keep in mind, these Discord messages were before Angela uploaded that voicemail of Jamie. And you asked, wow, he's such a scumbag. And she says, yes, he really is. I have some voicemails that I've been meaning to put on YouTube with him. I just haven't gotten around to it yet. They're kind of old. They show how abusive he is. And that is exactly what that voicemail showed, is how abusive George is.
Well, and she says voicemails, and she only has posted that one. I think the other one on that channel was posted before she made this comment. So that makes me think that there are still more to be added. Prepare to be added, George.
Prepare to be added. Angela, if you're listening to this, please drop those voicemails. Please. We need to keep the awareness of George Yared being a public menace. We need all the evidence we can gather. It's already damning and overwhelming, and we've got a boatload of evidence, enough to light up a Christmas tree, as George would say.
It's sort of like if you ever watch those fantasy movies where or TV shows where there's like an evil king or something, and the entire road up to the castle, there are bodies posted on hooks and shit. Consider these voicemails a warning to other women, sort of like those bodies in those movies, on what could happen to them should they allow George to get too close.
And another thing that they do is these videos that we make and that Mark posts and that Angela's posting go to even discredit further George is the people that decide to ally with George. So you listen to these voicemails, you listen to these calls, and they just show what a scummy human being George is. And then these people still defend him. Roger still defends him. Kevin still defends him. You know, Hank still defends him. Why? Roger, you know, we'll get into Roger later on, but these people don't seem to care about any of this. George just feeds them crap that it's all fake, it's all bullshit, and George can't ever provide any proof as to why they're false. But they just feed into his crap, and I don't get it.
That list is always dwindling, though. There's usually one or two people that are hangers-on that do help him, but the list always seems to dwindle. They always seem to drift away, and he always seems to do something to upset whoever is around him. I mean, look at the calls with Saunders as a good explanation as to why. The way he treats Saunders trying to give him money, and George is coming up with demands and making issues out of things when he should be grateful. You know, being a penniless pauper and having somebody try to give you something, you should be grateful.
Yes. And you asked Angela, was he already completely broke when you met him? And she says, yes, he was dirty and delivering pizzas for a living. I took him to Pizza Hut and paid. He ate almost the entire pizza and breadsticks.
Now he delivers food and pizzas for a living. And I think he tried to deny whether or not he's ever taken somebody's food. And there was some poll I saw recently where it was like three out of five DoorDashers admit to stealing food from their deliveries. And you just know George is among that three out of five.
Yes, it doesn't surprise. It would not surprise me at all. I would be surprised actually if it wasn't happening. The bag
I'm Captain
fries.
Corpulence and he is Captain Bag Fry. So Marty asked, do you believe George was ever sexually abused or at least physically abused by his janitor father? And Angela said he used to chase him around with a BB gun and tell him he would shoot him. So what? Didn't his dad shot a dog with a BB gun,
Yes,
supposedly?
and
So
that, yeah, that was confirmed by George to Sean.
basically, his dad looked at George as the family dog.
Well, George probably stank like a dog, and I'm sure he ate nonstop like a dog. Wouldn't eat anything like a dog would, and I wouldn't be surprised if it took George extra time to get potty trained. So he probably is still shitting on the carpet.
They probably, when they bathed George, it was like a dog. He took him around back and sprayed him down with a hose. And it might explain his reluctance to bait to this very day.
He could. He's just waiting for the janitor dad to come, take his clothes off and give a little butthole loving, and then take him out back and spray him down because he needs to clean himself off. That's what his dad does. Touch his butthole, throws a towel at him. Let's go clean you off, son. Takes him out back.
I want to bring up something else before we move on to the next comment. While we're on the topic of his father, what's with those toilet paper rolls that they were saving? It makes me remember, I think I read some spoof article that people would use those toilet paper rolls to make like homemade pocket pussies or something. So I just is that a, like a Yaridian trait where they were constructing pocket pussies for the lonely knights or something?
That I on there was a I we're not going to be able to pull the comment up, but there was a comment that we forgot to cover on the last podcast. Is someone asked George or asked Angela about her George's toilet paper use or some shit like that, and Angela said that George would get mad at Matt if he used more than one piece of toilet paper at a time. So those were pro the toilet paper rolls you saw inside of that medicine cabinet were probably all of the toilet paper rolls that George has used since his dad died, just kept up there because he used so few because George is poor and can't afford toilet paper for one, and two, that stinky ass according to Jamie. So he's not wiping his ass ever unless it's just one roll of toilet paper. Maybe that's why his hands are so brown too, because he's constantly got shit on them because he only uses one.
And what did Jamie say? She said, dirty, stinky ass. It
Yes,
all fits.
yes. Asked, that would possibly explain some of his demented behavior. Do you believe that you were at risk being raped like Jamie was? She said, he did try to get me drunk when I was there. He kept trying to offer me glasses of wine. I'm not a fan of red wine because it makes me sick, so I kept turning them down. And there's the same throwback to George trying to pump Jamie full of wine so he can have sex with her.
Maybe that's a learned behavior. Maybe he learned that from daddy.
Could
Maybe
be.
daddy plied him with wine and then did some butthole
Well,
touching.
since Grandpa Yared was a hypno rapist, I don't think maybe Daddy Yared didn't learn the trade, so he had to use he passed down to the next generation. Just use alcohol to get him drunk. You don't need to learn hypnotism.
You know what one of his favorite sayings is too? Vina Veritas.
Yes, and with wine, isn't that ironic? I forgot about that. That's a good point. With wine,
That
there's
might have something
truth.
to do with the Irish Rose.
Yeah, that was a. I think that was a Kristen saying too that she might have coined that, but then he just parrots it nonstop. But what was Kristen? Where there's coke, there's truth. That's where I don't know how to say that in Latin. But all right, moving on. We're gonna go to the subject of Roger. Okay, so for those who might have been puzzled by the video upload that Mark put on the channel, that video was uploaded by Roger to his channel a couple days prior to it going up on this channel. And Roger had posted that after George made that hour and a half long tirade video. And then people started flooding the comments because Roger, unlike George, does have somewhat of a nutsack. It might be very small, but he still has one and kept comments open. And he did not like the comments that were being left for him, and then he immediately basically deleted his channel. He removed all of his YouTube videos, and he is now in hiding. But don't worry, he's not truly in hiding because Henry and Jay are on the Regency Street case, if you will.
That was the fastest retreat I think I've ever seen. After all that bravado and chest beating that he knows how to deal with trolls and he's not afraid and no one's going to mess with him. What was it? It was just a few hours, wasn't it? Like before that, all the content was deleted.
It was
And
less than 24 hours. Yeah, it was. Because someone, I remember, he put it up, and then there was a post in Discord about 17 hours later that was like, "Where'd that video of Roger go?" And he took it down. He is, for someone who's got, according to him, family members in the government and lawyers, and he can look people up and all this stuff. He pussied out pretty quick. That's record time.
Well, I like the fact that he made a big deal that he can look people up. But it's the same thing George has been doing for years. George has been using those same sites, and look where it's gotten him. that's gotten him into a van, sleeping in Dick's parking lot in Oshkosh Bagosh. So, Roger, if you want to go down that path, bust loose, buddy.
It's also got him excellent identifiers such as William Royster, and he still isn't sure who Marty is. He doesn't know who any of the inner circle is. And if it wasn't for Henry basically and Jay basically telling him their names, he wouldn't know their names either. He's in this. So maybe if George and Roger put their one brain cell together and rub them, they might be able to discover who some of us are. But I doubt it, given that Roger called Bob Floyd's picture of Magic Matt Jerry Seinfeld.
How do you even get that? There's zero resemblance between the two of them.
I mean,
the only thing they have in common is that they like underage girls. Because I think Jerry Seinfeld had that 16-year-old girlfriend or something at one time.
It doesn't make any sense to me. They don't look similar at all. Roger is just kind of a brain idiot. And we talk about how Roger just snorts at least, like, someone did a count in the comments. I think it was like 16 times or something like that. He snorts like every three sentences. I too much coke use. Roger looks like just, I, there was a comment too that was made that Roger looks like he's done so much LSD that his brain has several holes in him. It just doesn't surprise me at all.
I want to know what Roger thought he was going to accomplish.
Yeah.
When he sat down to make that video, what did he think was going to happen? Did he think that all the trolls were going to watch it? Well, I think he only thinks there's like one or two trolls, but do you think they'd watch it and suddenly say, you know what, this monotone guy that snorts all the time and looks like a kitty tamperer, he's right. We should leave George alone.
Yeah. And I don't get what he was trying to accomplish either. No one was scared by that video. No one was intimidated. And as pointed out by just almost every single person that watched that video and commented, that sounded like he was reading a script that George just put in front of him and just, you know, ad nauseum, just word by word, verbatim reading. Those sounded like George Yared talking points, essentially.
Oh yeah, and we've heard and seen other people kind of do similar things. But what set this one apart, like we spoke about earlier, is just how fast he realized what a mistake it was.
Yes.
And just tried to pull a vanishing act on the internet as fast as he could.
Yeah, and there was, I think the problem is that George gets these people on his show, doesn't explain the trolls very well, and he tells these people that we're just a bunch of self-loathing people that live in our parents' basement and, you know, whack off to everything he says, and we can't do anything, and blah, blah, blah. And then he did the same thing with Sarah Capelli. Sarah Capelli thought that we were just a bunch of, you know, nobodies and lowlives because, according to what George sent her, but when the heat got put on her pretty hard, she didn't like it, and she flipped on him. She took money to flip on George. And Sarah Cash Money Capelli, as she's referred to, and it's the same thing with Roger. He feeds them that we're nothing, and then when we come at him and we get into his real world, then they don't know what to do.
Well, it's similar to what George always does, where he says, so which one is it? Am I a pauper, or do I pay for prostitutes? With these people, it's which one is it? Are they on George's side or are they not? They decide pretty quickly that they're not on George's side once they get a little taste of what some of the goons are capable of. And yes. Roger made that choice very, very quickly.
So how does George explain this off? So we have people in George's real world to the point where we're able to put a tracker on his car and track him for months before the battery starts to die. Then we just give it up to him that we have it there so he can find it and get mad about it. But do a bunch of self-loathing chronic masturbators who sit in their mom's basement, are they able to pull off getting a tracker on someone's van like that? Or are they able to get him fired from jobs or interfere with his day-to-day, control his every single move that he makes, control that he doesn't put shows up when he goes live? He only does it on Facebook for certain people, doesn't air everything, doesn't air his birthday bash live. Just everything George does is tries to be in secret to hide from the goons, but we don't control him. We're nobody, you know, that type of false narrative that George weaves.
Yeah, and you know, he spends his every waking moment thinking about action and reaction. If I do X, what do the goons do? Or I need to do X to avoid the goons. This is a guy that isn't in control of anything. Not even where he sleeps at night. He has to move probably every couple hours because the cops roused him, or someone is peering into his window. He has zero control.
We saw that on our tracker information showed that when that George would move every 2 or 3 hours, he'd move parking lots when we started putting up the pressure on him, saying, reporting where he was after Jay Smith called him and told him where he was. And George is moving every 2 or 3 hours from Dick's Sporting Goods to Oshkosh Bagosh, and he's going all over that. If that doesn't sound like the actions of someone who is not afraid of people finding out where he is, that sounds like the actions of someone who's petrified and is constantly needing to move either because he's being harassed or he's afraid he's being followed.
What I want to know is if he and Roger are such good friends, why isn't he staying with Roger? Why isn't Roger opening his door and saying, "Come on in, George. You and the lizards have a place to stay now."
I imagine that Roger probably lives in some 200 square foot place that he pays way too much money for, some dingy place in the middle of, the Jeff Davis or, Midlothian Turnpike underneath a bridge somewhere. And he's probably got Section 8, and George is too fat. He'd take up half the place when he walks in. I'm sure Roger's got a microwave and a mattress in there, which is more than George has, but that Roger doesn't. I highly doubt it. And Roger, well, I'll be surprised if we see Roger on further shows, to be honest, given how much pressure has been put on him recently. And that tends to happen. George underestimates us, he talks us down, and then he ends up losing friends because he doesn't tell people the true narrative, and we end up setting that narrative for him, like usual.
Makes me wonder too. He says a lot of negative things about a certain apartment in North Hollywood.
He does.
But how could your luxurious apartment not be better than a van in a parking lot?
My apartment, we'll set the narrative straight since George likes to talk shit. My apartment was never raided. My apartment was never ransacked. And you can't live in a ransack apartment. That doesn't make any sense. Ransacking is destroying the place. My place is not constantly being destroyed, George. I live in a nice apartment. You're jealous of it. Get over yourself. And Bruce Willis does know who I am, but you would never be able to ask him because he wouldn't give you the time of day to some local fat delivery boy public access failure. And I bet if we asked Susie Quattro who you were, if she even remembered their interview, she would say, "Yeah, that's the guy that said my last name and then asked me how to pronounce my last name and then asked me all these insulting questions about people that were more famous than me and if I took inspiration from them." It just that entire interview was a disaster. That's a subject for another podcast, I think. But don't forget, George says he's not a public figure, but in the intro to that interview says that he likes to think of himself as somewhat of a celebrity, and I think he told Susie that too. Not a public
I
figure,
wonder,
though.
how many times was it that you told him what kind of car you drive and he didn't know what an Audi was?
Yeah, he doesn't know what that is. And this is a guy that loves German cars, but he's got his Benz that he had to scrap, and he's so full of shit. George, none of us are driving rickety old soccer mom vans that we paid 3 times more than the actual value is of those cars. And then you're just one Mexican away from losing it all.
And how many hundreds of thousands of miles is on that thing?
He said when he picked it up that it had about 250,000.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. That thing's not long for this world.
No, it's not. Well, hopefully the same can be said about George.
Well, I think the most recent pictures we've seen of it too, it looks like it's got a few war wounds.
Yeah, it does. There's battle damage on the front of the car, but that must have came with it because George has a pristine driving record, according to him.
Right.
He's also got a pristine criminal record too with his assault and battery charges, but other than that, doesn't have a record.
Well, I think the inheritance money helped with that.
Oh, yeah, that's right. He would have more. He would have a domestic abuse charge, but you know, against his aunt, but Aunt Ava decided to save him from that.
I wonder what his dad used to say to him when he was chasing him with the BB gun.
Boy, come here.
Boy!
Boy, come here. He sounded like fucking Kratos talking to his son. Boy.
Boy, bring that butthole
Daddy's hungry. Daddy wants to give rim jobs. Get over here.
over
For anybody that is looking to join the community, we do have a Discord, and I'll put a link to that in the YouTube or in the description of this video as well. We don't, for anybody that listens on the Facebook page or whatever, we don't really use that much anymore. Everything's done in Discord. So we've got a really good community in there, a lot of great goons, constant conversation going. So if you want to learn more about what we're doing the day to day, or just chat with a community of like-minded people that like setting the narrative and correcting everything that George does and critiquing George, then that's going to be the place for you. And George, join the Discord, man. We want you to. We want you to get there. Go in there and change. Go into the snake pit and show you have a sack and change the narrative.
Yeah, you can sign up as Platinum Dracula or Nuclear Furniture,
Nuclear
whichever name you
furniture.
want to use. You're more than welcome. It's fun to harass you on YouTube, but it'd be equally as fun to do it over on Discord. So come on over.
We can even get Angela to come back in the Discord when you decide to join, and you guys can battle it out instead of making, you know, pussy little videos about Angela. And we invite you fully to keep attacking Angela, because that's why we got the voicemail we did. Keep doing it, George. Keep poking the lion, as you say, because unlike you, Angela was a lion being poked in a cage, and she got out of the cage and she mauled you hard.
She didn't prod a stick at a lion. She mauled like a lion.
Yes, she did. But George is a constant lion that is constantly getting prodded. So, all right, guys. And I think that about wraps up everything that we have to talk about. A lot of big news that happened the past couple weeks. It's been quite an eventful thing since our last podcast. And I'd also like to thank everybody. That podcast is now over 1,000 views on YouTube. That's way more than George has ever gotten on any of his shows, showing that that this season of the Gorgeous George Show is continuing strong. We've got Mark's channel has got over 200 subscribers now, so thank you for everybody that subscribed. Captain, any closing words as we end this podcast?
Yeah, man, I'm just really honored to be here yet again, and I was tickled to see how fast the views stacked up on that video. Quite a contrast to the boar fests that arrive on Gorgeous George on DVD.
Anything that arrives on Gorgeous George on DVD, unless it's a tirade, no one cares about. I can't even stomach listening to anything that George has to say unless it's about trolls. If he's not talking about us, then I don't think it's worth listening to.
If you don't have narcolepsy before you watch one of those videos, you're gonna figure out what it's like.
And that's the irony, is that George said that Keith and Kevin's show can cure insomnia, yet George's show is the most boring, inarticulate thing that you could possibly find, with a drug-addled moron and a serial abuser slash rapist on the mic here, and they are just awful. It's just terrible in every single way and fashion. So thank you guys for listening, and next time there's big news, we'll be for sure to come back and review all of it. And thank you guys, and take care, and we'll end out with Southern Nights.